Welcome to the Public Safety and Health Committee meeting. This is my first meeting as chair, having been sworn in about a month ago. We are scheduled for 1 hour and I intend to conclude at 7 p.m. There are two items on the agenda tonight. And I guess I should formally call the meeting to order first before I go further. All right. The first item on the agenda is going to be a review of Chapter 531 of our municipal ordinances, which is the city's minor curfew law, and in particular, those provisions that were enacted in 2011 concerning Lee Road, Severance, and the Coventry Business Districts, and consideration as to whether council should now act to repeal those provisions. The second item on the agenda is to begin to address the issues raised from the Cleveland State traffic stop study. I want to caution that there is more to that study and its ramifications that can be covered tonight. I assure everyone that in the future, we will hold as many meetings as necessary to arrive at a concrete action plan to ensure the city has, in the words of the CSU report, unbiased, equitable enforcement of traffic laws, and I would add unbiased, equitable enforcement of all of our laws. Before I get to the agenda, as I think everyone is aware, City Council has passed legislation forming a racial justice task force that we are in the process of finalizing after having selected a chair and a vice chair. That was done under the auspices of this committee before I became a member. And I want to thank in particular DeVita Russell and Assistant Chairperson Mike Unger for the heavy lifting they did before I came on this committee. Mike or DeVita, I don't know if there's anything that you want to comment on regarding that task force before we actually begin the agenda items.
Well, I'm happy to just give a very, very brief report, and DeVita can feel free to supplement if she wants to. You know, we've been working hard on getting this thing launched, and admittedly, we've had a couple of hiccups along the way, but I'm pleased to report that we are nearly ready to receive the recommendations from the leadership as to the constitution of the rest of the committee. We hope the staff is in the middle of facilitating that review by the committee leadership as we speak, and we hope to have those recommendations back soon. I spoke with Rhonda Davis Lovejoy, the chair, last week, and I know she's chomping at the bit to get started. Clearly, there is some complement and intersection between what I anticipate the task force committee is going to be looking at and some of the issues that we'll be discussing, perhaps even this evening, addressing unbiased and equitable policing. So stay tuned, hopefully, and I'm confident there will be a lot more to report going forward. So thank you for the opportunity to update everybody on that.
Sure. Ms. Russell, did you have any comments?
Sure, just a few. I just want to thank you for acknowledging that and to let the citizens of Cleveland Heights know we're really serious about systemic racism and truly trying to put a stop to it and to make our city more of a whole city where all are welcome, just like our banner says. So we hope that the Justice Task Force deal with a lot of these issues and bring forth some resolution and some legislation at not only the local level, but as the federal level, as we have Sherrod Brown's a liaison to be on that committee as well. So thank you very much for letting us be a part of this task force and moving it forward. So hopefully soon we'll get it together. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your comments. I think as Mike mentioned, these agenda items would be matters that our task force would be taking a look at. I think this council realizes that these matters are too important to wait. So this is going to be our start to address these issues now, and hopefully will provide some foundation for the task force to build on as they meet going forward. So let's get to the first agenda item, which is our curfew. And Susanna, I don't know if you're going to take the lead on discussing the history of this, or it's going to be the chief or a combination.
I can say a few words about how it came about. It was during the era of flash mobs, and the merchants in the Coventry area and at Severance and at Cedar Lea were very concerned about young people gathering and going up and down the street. If anyone was ever in one, you know that flash mobs were pretty scary moments. And then Mayor Wilcox and I were in one together on Coventry. So we saw that up close. And then it came to council, and through the law department, this legislation was put into place. So time has gone by, and the chief has a strong recommendation for you. And I think it's important that she looked at data and also what is going on now in our merchant districts. So chief, if you would like to respond.
Thank you, Susanna. Yes, Susanna stated the business district curfew laws were enacted in response to flash mobs that occurred at the Coventry Street Fair in June of 2010 and June of 2011. Basically, the flash mobs consisted of kids running around in large crowds. Sometimes they were fighting each other, sometimes knocking people to the ground. And in the last street fair that we had, we ended up having to make 16 arrests. So in June of 2011, City Council passed legislation establishing curfew zones in the Coventry Village and Cedar Lea business districts. These basically stated that no one under the age of 18 was permitted in these districts between the hours of 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. The code did provide for some exceptions, including minors accompanied by a parent or family member 18 years of age or older, when on an errand or legitimate business, such as going to the library, when engaged in gainful employment, or when going to or returning home by a direct route from the end of a school activity, such as a sporting event or a religious activity. Later in the year, November 2011, the business district curfew extended to include Severance Town Center. Do you want me to just go on into the stats that I was able to compile regarding this?
Yes, that would be helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Since enactment of the ordinance, 187 minors were found to be in violation of the business district curfew law. Of these 187 violations, 66% of the calls were complaints that were called into our dispatch, while only 34% of them were officer initiated, which means the officer noticed someone underage and stopped them. Majority of these 187 violations, 151 of them, occurred between the years 2011 to 2015. Then between 2016 and 2020, we only had 36 violations of the business district curfew law. During this 5-year period, the curfew violations that we dealt with were only charged in those instances where minors were stopped and/or charged with another offense, such as theft. We had some vandalism to the lot 5 parking garage, the disturbance, fight, a robbery. So there had to be a reason that we were stopping them. At no time during the last 5 years did we proactively stop a juvenile in the business district curfew after 6 p.m. and charge them solely for being in that curfew district. The last time a minor was stopped and parents received a civil penalty strictly for their child being in violation of the business district curfew was actually in 2015. So we looked at the data. While we did not gauge the age, or we could not do the data based on the location, we were unable to get that in a timely manner, which business district curfews these were all in. We did get the race, and of the violations that occurred in which civil penalties were applied, over 93% of the minors were Black, just under 4% were white, and 2.6% were of unknown race. So based on our findings and our belief of this law, while we feel that maybe there was a time and place for it, the police department does not feel that the law is needed anymore. And therefore, it's our recommendation that council consider repealing the law.
Thank you, Chief. I'll ask whether any council members have any questions on this issue with the chief, and I'll start with the committee members first. Mike, do you have any questions for the chief on this issue?
I do not have any questions. I think that's a great report and understand the recommendation. Thank you.
Ms. Russell?
I have no questions on the report. Just like to have a copy of it as well. Just for my records, I've been trying to take a little notes of it, but it'd be good to have a copy of it as well. Okay. And hopefully we're going to do away with this curfew. So,
yeah. Khalil?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a quick question. When you're talking about potentially repealing this, are you speaking specifically about the business district sections that include just the business districts that you listed earlier? No other portion of the curfew section?
Well, the only other curfew section would be, you know, a general city curfew. Is that what you're referring to?
No, just wanted to be clear about what you were recommending.
Yeah, we're the business district curfews for Coventry, Cedar Lea, and Severance. Okay. Those are the only three districts that have business curfews. So those are the ones we've had no problems with flash mobs in several years. So, and we've had no major problems with juveniles either. So, based on our recommendation, we don't see the need for this at this time.
All right. All right. There is, I guess I can pull it up, but there's another section that was enacted during the same time, and it's related specifically to flash mobs. It adds a power to implement sort of an emergency curfew as a result of suspected flash mob activity. It's not specific to the business districts. I doubt that anyone has ever used it, but I'm not really sure. But, you know, in the context, certainly in a 2021 context where state legislatures all over the country are enacting anti-protest measures that sort of criminalize even peaceful protest in certain instances. This flash mob-based emergency curfew power, if it was enacted at the time as a result of that, and we haven't really seen a use for it, in this context, I'd like to propose that we consider repealing that section as well.
My understanding, I thought we were repealing all of the curfews for Cleveland Heights. And all areas.
There are some that were already existent curfews just for minors generally based on various ages in the city. I don't think that we've had any complaints about those curfews or any concerns about those already existing curfews.
Well, I think that's something certainly that we can talk about further. I would point out that part of the curfew ordinance, and it may need some work to address your concerns, Khalil, does make sure that minors' First Amendment rights are not infringed in enforcing this curfew. So perhaps that needs to be tightened up or worked on to make sure that their First Amendment rights are fully protected under our curfew, regardless of whether we repeal the flash mob portion or not. Okay, are there any other council members on? Okay, anything further from the chief or Susanna on this? Mike?
Well, can I just ask for a little bit of additional input from our legal department, not now, but going forward, a little bit concerned. I want to make sure that whatever we do doesn't impinge on our incoming mayor's ability to act in the event of an emergency. So in other words, I don't want to get out over our skis. If our mayor, just like the mayors in all major cities regrettably have had to do from time to time in recent news in response to a mob action, civil disobedience, smashing store windows, whatever we've seen on and witnessed on the television in a way that causes danger or injury to frankly our residents, but others as well. I just want to make sure whatever we do here and whatever we recommend here doesn't impinge on the mayor's ability to act swiftly and in his or her best judgment in the event that, God forbid, that should happen. I don't expect it to happen, but I think it's an important power to reserve to the chief executive officer.
We will definitely look at that. I'll talk to Bill Hanna.
Thank
and
you,
have him do a review of that.
Thank you. And I don't think anybody's intending to in any way restrict our incoming mayor, but I out of an abundance of caution, I just want to make sure we can. Thank you.
Fair enough.
And until that person's in order, Susanna, same goes for you.
Okay.
By that position. Okay. Thank you.
Susanna, did we contact or reach out to the business districts on Lee Road and Coventry about this?
You know, we did not, but we did know that Cedar Lee was very supportive of repealing this. That we did know. I did not speak to Coventry.
All right. So I'm assuming that we'll take this up at a council meeting, and we need to make sure that those business districts do know that we're considering this.
Yeah, and I will definitely contact Coventry SID director, and I'll contact Kelly. In fact, I'll contact them tomorrow and tell them that this is likely going to happen, but what is their feedback on it?
Okay.
I'll do that tomorrow.
Okay, thanks. All right, anything further before we move on to the next agenda item?
Don't you think there should be some verbiage regarding lawful gathering versus an unlawful gathering? I think that would clear up a lot of issues with this.
I'm not exactly following what you mean by that.
So a lawful gathering being a peaceful protest versus a mob activity where people are smashing windows and there's, damage being done to property or businesses.
Yeah, I don't think there's any attempt to, prevent our enforcement when you have a mob act going on. So I don't think it's any intention that we're going to change any laws or pass any laws that's going to impact that. Go ahead, Khalil.
Thank you, Chair. So I know that what we're discussing specifically has to do with the minor curfews, and that's found in one section of the code. And then in a second section, we've got disorderly conduct and peace disturbance, and we've got a subsection that includes riot and failure to disperse and that kind of thing, which is a separate area than the minors curfew chapter. So I just wanted to make sure that as we're talking about changing the minor curfew area, that will have no impact on the section of the code that has specifically to do with riot and that kind of thing. So I just wanted to make sure that we're clear on that.
That's right.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Khalil, thanks a lot for pointing that out. That was a great comment. Okay. Moving on to the second agenda item, which is to begin to look at this Cleveland State study and the traffic stops. I'm assuming that the chief is going to take the lead on this. And Chief, I think it would be helpful, at least for me, and I'm assuming some other council members in the public, if you could share with us your background in law enforcement and your history with the department. before we start addressing some of the items under the study, if you'd be willing to do that.
Yes, I would be happy to do that. And then I'm going to ask the other two members of the police department that are here with me if they can also share their background. So you know who else is on the meeting here with us, if that's okay.
That's perfect. Thanks.
Okay. Great. I started here in 1990. Prior to that, I had just completed my bachelor's degree at Bowling Green State University. I obtained a bachelor's degree in criminal justice. It's always been my desire to be a police officer, and that dates back to when I was a kid. It's just something that's in me and something I've always wanted to do, you know, make a difference in society. So upon graduating from the academy, I started here as a basic patrol officer. I worked in dispatch, I walked a beat, and I worked the traffic unit for about 2.5 years until I was promoted to PO. I was on the shift on general patrol for several years until I was transferred over to the police academy. Just prior to that, I worked a permanent midnight shift so that I could attend law school. And I obtained my JD from Cleveland State University, Cleveland Marshall College of Law. However, I will point out, I am not an attorney. I did not take the bar. My heart, my soul, everything has always been in law enforcement, but I wanted to get the education because I felt it would benefit me here in my performance of my duties. So at the police academy, I did a lot of administrative with the basic police cadets. I also became an instructor in a wide variety of topics, including subject control, stops and approaches, physical conditioning, and many other things. I then made sergeant and was transferred back to a shift. So I worked on a shift as a road patrol sergeant before making lieutenant. I ran a shift for a couple years, and then I was promoted to the position of captain, where I was in charge of the auxiliary bureau and was the jail administrator until making chief in February of 2016. I've attended a variety of trainings throughout my career, leadership classes, and that including crisis intervention training. So I do have a lot of education and a lot of training behind me that has benefited me and I think helped me to make the better police officer that I am today. So with me here today, I'll start with Captain Jeremy Young. He is in charge of our Detective Bureau. And then we also have Sergeant Sean Corrigan, and he is in charge of our Community Response Team, which also includes our Day Traffic Bureau.
Okay.
So, Captain Young.
Good evening, everybody. Mine will be much shorter. So, I've been here since 2001. I started as a basic patrol officer. I worked in dispatch for about a year, and then I moved on to patrol. I was on patrol for quite a few years. I made sergeant in about 2009. I was a supervisor of the patrol division for 2 years as a sergeant. In 2011, I made lieutenant. And I worked as a lieutenant for 7 years, commanding a shift of the patrol officers. I made captain in 2018, where I worked in the chief's office with auxiliary services. And then beginning of last year, I started as a captain of the Detective Bureau. Where we handle all the crimes here. I do have a master's in criminal justice from University of Cincinnati and among a lot of training too, but I know our time is limited. So that's about it.
Thank you, Captain. Sergeant. You're muted.
How's that?
Go ahead.
Okay, Mr. Chairman. Again, my name is Sergeant Sean Corrigan. Currently, I am with the Traffic Bureau under the Community Response Team. I've been here for 16 years as a police officer. I had over 25 years in law enforcement. I started while I was in law school. I worked for the Tyler County Prosecutor's Office as an investigator. I handled most of the abuse, neglect, and dependency cases with Children and Family Services. And the goal there was to have better resources and also to improve on how police officers handle their investigations so we could have more successful cases. Then I decided that I really wanted to become a police officer and not an attorney. So then I joined our police academy, and when I joined the police academy, I was hired on as a basic patrol officer. I walked the beat, Coventry Road beat, and also Cedar Fairmont beat. Then I also did traffic, and then I was promoted to a shift. Then I became a sergeant, and then I also was a sergeant supervisor, detective sergeant in the detective bureau. And currently, as I stated, I am now with the community response team and in charge of the traffic operations.
Thank you, Sergeant. Okay, I had no idea we had these many people with JDs in our department. So Chief, let's get to the study. Could you tell us what precipitated this study, if anything?
Last year, you know, there were many horrific events that were portrayed in the media that actually, you know, occurred involving police officers, and there was a lot of call for more police transparency, police reform, and things like that. So myself, the city manager, the vice city manager at the time, you know, we had discussions on what we can do. So we had started collecting our traffic data in 2019, which was about a year earlier, for other reasons, and a lot of that was transparency. We felt it best, and we owed it to our residents to you know, let them know what their police department was doing. So we had the data, but we did not know exactly how to proceed with it. So the city manager suggested Cleveland State University, therefore she reached out to them, and we worked out a contract with them to have them look at it and give us their analysis of it.
Okay, thanks. So to help me, and I think the other council members and the public understand what all is involved in the traffic enforcement and who does it, how many officers we have, what they do, could you enlighten us about all of that?
Mm-hmm. We have a dedicated traffic bureau, and we have 33 basic patrol officer positions. We used to have 37, but for as long as I've been chief, and even before that, 4 of those have been frozen due to budget cuts. So 33. However, we are currently only staffed at 22. So we are 11 down. We have been desperately trying to hire. We don't have nearly as many applicants as we used to. We do, however, get some, but we do have very, you know, rigorous standards that we want our police officers to meet, because we owe that to our community. So some of them have not been able to meet those standards, whether it be, you know, a background check or the psychological evaluation. So due to already having low numbers, we also have had some trouble getting good quality candidates to be police officers. But the basic patrol officer's position was originally intended to just be a stepping stone position onto the PO position. It did not require any college education, just that you be a certified police officer in the state of Ohio. Their primary job responsibilities today are traffic enforcement and assist in the jail as needed. Prior to that, they also worked in were our dispatchers. That's why many of us started in dispatch. We didn't have a lot of civilian. We had maybe one civilian dispatcher back then, and so it was all manned by police officers. But since regionalizing now, they basically do traffic enforcement.
And so do these typically tend to be the least experienced, least, I don't want to use the word educated, but the least experienced officers are doing the traffic enforcement?
No, not necessarily. They are many of our new officers who eventually do move up to the position of PO, but we do have several that have stayed in that position. Some have even retired from that position years ago. Some enjoyed that position, and they've remained there. So we have currently have officers who have 15, 20 years plus experience as police officers in the basic patrol officer position.
And the new officers, do we give them any specific training, handling traffic stops, how to go about doing that before they actually begin? Can you tell us about that?
Yes, we have a police training program, and part of that police training program is traffic enforcement. They ride 16 weeks at least, maybe longer, with an experienced trained officer who's gone through the course on how to be a training officer. And they do learn, in addition to what they training they had in the academy on performing traffic stops, they also receive additional on-the-job training in traffic stops. And we also do periodic legal updates to make sure that all our officers are aware of all the laws, search and seizure, and all of those. So yes, they do receive on-the-job training.
And has any of that training involved any implicit bias training?
There is some training in the basic police academy, but end of last year and into this year, we did the 8 hours of cultural competency and implicit bias training. That is the first training that we've done in the department that I'm aware of. Part of our psychological evaluation that we do through the company Pradco does have some built-in testing methods that they use to try to determine if anyone has any predispositions or might have some biases that they can pick up on, and those will come out in their report.
Okay. Someone asked me, and I didn't have the answer to this question, whether these officers have any ticket quotas they need to fill.
Ticket quotas are illegal. Therefore, we do not have ticket quotas.
Okay.
In fact, in the new policy will come out, it's going to, you know, explicitly state that, you know. We don't currently have a policy, but no such thing as a quota.
Okay. And someone shared with all of the council members a study that the Safer Heights had done showing where traffic stops were occurring. Have you had an opportunity to see that report yet for the study?
Yes. Someone provided me with the report. Yes.
And do you have any comments after looking at it? Anything surprising?
As to where the traffic stops are, no. We mapped our own. We had that done as well to get an idea, and what their map showed was fairly accurate.
Okay. And do we, having lived in Cleveland Heights for a while, I know that there are areas that there's typically going to be an officer with radar. How do we go about determining what areas we have radar and what areas we more heavily patrol than others?
There are a lot of different factors that come into play. We will look at, if we're experiencing a higher number of automobile accidents. Also a lot of it is resident complaints. You'll see in the business districts and that I get a lot of complaints from residents about the pedestrian crossings. On the side streets, we get a lot of complaints from residents about speeders. I just got another one today. So some of those streets off of Taylor's, there's a lot of stop signs. It's a very walkable area. I get a lot of complaints about speeding and stop signs violations. So we will patrol that more heavily and do more traffic enforcement. Up in the, and this wasn't recent, but over the last couple of years, up in the northern end of town off of Noble, I was attending a lot of the Meet Your Police meetings at the Police Academy, and I heard a lot from residents in that area about the lack of police presence and the lack of patrols and enforcement. And they wanted to see more of us. So I made sure the bosses assigned more officers to that area. You know, they were experiencing some higher levels of crime, and they wanted more enforcement. So that's what we did. Streets like Pomona, Elmwood, and that, stop sign violations. Some of the other streets, Woodview, Neela View, areas off of Monticello, speeding violations. So again, a lot of resident complaints come into play when we talk about assigning officers. So that also plays a part in it.
Could you walk us through how our officers are trained in terms of when they're doing a traffic stop, how they're dealing with, and how they're instructed to deal with the driver, the passenger, under what circumstances they're searching a car, searching a person, asking them to step outside of the vehicle, things like that?
Okay, if I'm going to turn this over to Sergeant Corrigan, since he's in charge of our traffic bureau, and let him provide you with some answers to those questions. Sergeant Corrigan.
You're muted again, Sergeant.
Sometimes that's a good thing. With regards to our traffic stops, the first thing that I want to point out is that our traffic stops are done because there was an observable violation. So someone was breaking a law or ordinance of the city of Cleveland Heights, and that, you know, gives them the probable cause to make a legal traffic stop. So with regards to those stops, I know that there seems to be some issues with regards to whether people's constitutional rights are being violated. You know, we stress, having a police academy here, that our stops have to be legal, first and foremost. There's enough violations out there that we can actively patrol, and we can reduce crime, and we can also reduce traffic violations by just following and enforcing our ordinances. I know that what were some of the other questions that you had?
Sure. So I you know, what circumstances, you've said when we're stopping people, but then after the stop, well, what are we doing? Are our officers, are they given instructions about how they should approach the driver, what they should tell the driver? Under what circumstances are they asking someone to step out of the car, asking a passenger to produce, you know, ID? What training are we giving them to make sure that the situations are de-escalated rather than escalated in a traffic stop?
Right, that's a good question. You know, them being up on the legal issues with regards to traffic stops, you know, we are doing our stops, like I said, for those types of violations that are observed by the officer. I looked at, you know, we do review our body cam with regards to our traffic stops. We do that monthly. Myself as a supervisor, and some of the other supervisors do make sure that we are, you know, reviewing these stops. So with regards to how they are conducted, obviously it's, you know, it depends on the officer and the safety issues. Sometimes they'll do a passenger side approach. Sometimes they do driver side approaches. What they do and what we instruct them to do is to identify themselves and also to give the reason why they're being pulled over. So, you know, they say, I'm Officer Corrigan, Cleveland Heights Police Department, and the reason you're being stopped is for speed. Can I please see your driver's license and proof of insurance? And with regards to passengers, if there's any type of, you know, we follow the law of Michigan, be long. If there's some something in the car that's plain view, or there's reasonable suspicion that something is going on in the car, maybe if there's a that they could be armed or dangerous, then they do have a right, because the traffic officer is controlling the stop. They do have a right to ask people to exit the vehicle, and you know, then they can do a pat down with regards to weapons. So with regards to you know, randomly searching the car, you know, we do not do that. We can ask if we have some type of suspicion on a stop. We can ask for consent, and that is perfectly legal to do. So you could ask consent to search a vehicle, or the officer could ask, you know, is there anything illegal in the car? Do you have drugs or a weapon? So they can ask those types of questions. But again, you know, they have to have some type of suspicion that, you know, that a crime is being committed, or one that already has been committed. So that's pretty much, I hope that explains it.
And then what's the procedure with tickets? Are these written with paper?
Yeah, so all the tickets are citation, and each officer has a citation book. They fill out the citation by hand, and you know, they give a copy to the driver with instructions on how to take care of it. If it's a waiverable offense, they can pay it, or if they are needed to go to court, if it's a non-waiverable offense and they're required to go to court. Those tickets then are reviewed by a supervisor, and then they are turned into the court. So that's the procedure on that.
All right. And I don't know if you're able to address this or not, but one of the items that came out of the study pertained to our inability to be able to identify the specific type of citation written.
Correct. Yeah, that's I think that's the recommendation for the e-citation that would include that. We didn't have anything in our CAD system that would allow us to identify that, and the court's system does not have anything that would allow us to easily determine the types of citations that are being issued.
And maybe this is a question best directed at the chief. Are we taking some steps or working with the court system to address that deficiency?
Yes, the court does have a system, and I think there was some mistaken beliefs by some people in our community that the officers were reporting the data just fine. We've used the uniform traffic citation for the 30 years I've been here. They're completely filled out, and they've always, you know, they include race. However, at the court level, there was a training problem where they weren't always inputting the race data into the computer system. That's why we could not achieve or retrieve that data to see what people were being cited for. But that has since been corrected, and moving forward, starting in 2021, it won't be an issue. We are in conversations with the judge. We've had several meetings with the judge regarding e-citations. I can give you a little bit on the cost if you want me to go into that now, but you know, we're looking at printers, we're looking at mounting brackets, we're looking at some other equipment, but we're looking at about $105,000 for the equipment alone, plus installation. We have nearly 50 police cars, and if we want it to work right, every police officer, no matter what car they're driving, is going to have access to those citations.
Okay, and I see that we're coming up on 10 off, and there was a lot of stuff that I wanted to get to, and I anticipated at the beginning we wouldn't get to everything. So Chief, we'll schedule another meeting next month to pick some things up. I did want to allow council members to ask you some questions about what we've covered so far tonight, knowing that there's a lot of things that we did not get to, and I didn't anticipate that we would. But in the short term, I mean, what resources do you need from the city or for council to provide you to be able to address the concerns that were raised in this traffic study so we can start working on that now. I know you mentioned the printers and the equipment for the cars. Are there other things? And I'm not to put you on the spot, but if you could get together your wish list and have that for us the next time we get together, that would be greatly appreciated.
Additional money for training for officers. And we're just talking about legal updates and that. We need to look at our RMS system to see what else we can possibly start to, what information we can start to record. And possibly an additional data entry civilian position to be filled. Those are just a couple of the beginnings, but I can get you more information.
Okay, and the anticipated budget costs and everything. And then just one final question again, and I'm sort of getting ahead of ourselves. Is there anything that you can tell us right now about what the department or you have done or are doing to address the issues that were raised by this CSU study? To make sure that we know that we are headed in the right direction right now.
Well, we're reviewing the data further to see exactly what we have there. I will be one of the ones to admit we have some concerns over how the data was analyzed. And that was because the benchmark that was used was the census population. And due to the fact that it was, it is not recent data, that is kind of concerning. A lot's changed over the years. So I have asked Dr. Dunn to perhaps get updated census data that regarding the driving population to see if that's going to make a difference. And who is driving through Cleveland Heights. Just as we have an issue with a lot of the people who commit crimes in Cleveland Heights, they're not Cleveland Heights residents. It's my belief that a lot of people we stop are not Cleveland Heights residents. So we get a lot of vehicular traffic from outside of Cleveland Heights. It's not just Cleveland Heights. We're also looking at our accident data. Some of my research has shown that by looking at accident data, that's going to give you a good benchmark as to the race and gender of the people that are driving in the community. And early preliminary indications on that indicate that it's a little more comparable to the people that are being stopped, the people that are involved in accidents. So we're looking into that as well. Again, just additional training for officers and ways that we can gather more information and record it so that we can continue to analyze these stops.
Chief, do you mind if I jump in here real quick?
No, not at all.
Okay. So I did run the checks a little bit. We try to look at which benchmarks to look at. And when I ran the accident data for 2019, it was a pretty large amount of drivers. I think it was over 1,200 drivers. And just looking at the accident data itself, the people that are actually on the road involved in accidents, just a quick initial look, it was 61% of the drivers involved in accidents were African-American, 36% were white and 3% Asian. So it's a little closer to what our traffic stop data looks like. And these are actually people on the roadway that are involved in traffic crashes, which is real data from the same system that we pull the other data from. And it's just a different way to look at it on who's driving on the streets as one small section that we could take at real data.
Yeah, and just to add to that really quick, in speaking with some of the officers, since I do interact with the officers that are making all of these traffic stops, just roughly pointing out our officers, 42% of our traffic officers are African American, 10% are white women, 42% are white males, and 6% are Hispanic. One officer also wanted to point out that we do have an openly gay officer and that one of the white males is married to an African American. So They were sort of offended by the implications of the study. And I think we are very good, and you know, we pride ourselves on being diverse, and being educated and knowing the law and doing the right thing and having integrity. So I just wanted to point that out too.
Okay, thank you. And on that note, I'm going to end it. Again, there was a lot of things that I was hoping to get to tonight and we didn't, but this is just the beginning. And we'll have another meeting and, you know, to address some of the issues that we didn't get to. Susanna, were you raising your hand?
Yes, I wanted to make a comment because I received calls from residents. And I want to reinforce the fact that we as a city asked for the study with CSU because our department was looking for ways to improve. This wasn't something that was imposed upon our police department. It was asked for. The police force is very open to the policies and procedures that we're studying. And I credit the chief and her team and the officer who has really looked at where we want to head and the transparency issue that we're committed to. So I just wanted to make that comment.
Okay, thanks. Vice Chairman Mike, do you have any final questions of anybody?
No, I'd just piggyback on all your questions. I think further analysis of the data and the inferences to be drawn therefrom makes a lot of sense. Getting the chief's wish list to address everything from training to printers to whatever else likewise makes a lot of sense. And I look forward to continuing the dialogue. I think we're on the right path and I appreciate everybody's effort. And I do think, I'll just say, I do think that our police force represents Cleveland Heights' finest. I've said it many times before. I'll say it again, I'm not afraid to say it. And I appreciate the openness and willingness by the chief and her colleagues to having this dialogue. I know it's not a fun one to have, but I'm appreciative of the way you're dealing with it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Davita, any questions or comments?
The police chief and I had a very candid discussion, and she truly knows how I feel. And I was not surprised by the study at all. Maybe a lot of residents in Cleveland Heights were, but I was not. Believe me, I know a little bit about the police because my brother is a police officer and a sergeant. So I'm very much aware of a lot of those different things, but I really want to soak up a lot of the information to pile together before I start to really dig into answering and asking some questions, because I do know that from talking to the chief that some of these things that I was aware of happened prior to her being the chief. And we were very candid about that. Mr. Copps was there, that a lot of things were not written, but somewhat in the mindset of the police department and other things. And so I plan to have more discussion with her and some of the police department. But I want to ask you too, Chief, is there a way that, say, a ride along with the police officer or with the police department having and meeting with the police officers, even some of our residents maybe taking a ride along and or meeting with some of the police officers to have a candid discussion. I mean, even with Safer Heights, with the map they presented, maybe they would be willing to sit down. And are you able to sit down with any resident or a group that may be outside of this racial justice task force that we're going to get up and running, where people can actually see what's going on? Because I have more questions, but I just want to reserve them for just getting more information under my belt first. But is there a way that any person or other groups can sit down and talk with the police department and random police officers to ask any questions?
Absolutely. You know, first Thursday of the month, and tomorrow's the first Thursday of the month, we always have Meet Your Police from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Information's on the city's website. It is virtual, still with COVID. I've always had an open door policy. I have residents all the time that want to contact me about issues in their neighborhood, things they want to talk to me directly, and I'll hold meetings here. I'll stay here at night. I go to Meet Your Police meetings. We've had community meetings, and I've spoken to the officers, and they are very much open to people, residents, council members, whomever. And I know some council members have, you know, ridden with officers. Mr. Cobb is one. Mr. Unger is another. But I encourage you, other council members, to come out and ride along. One or two officers, you know, split up your time, talk to them, get to know them. You know, they will speak freely to you about things in the community that, you know, they're dealing with and they see. And or if you'd like to have smaller meetings with a couple of the officers, you can come in, you know, visit roll call. They can talk to you after roll call, or we can set something up. They're all for that. They want to be part of the community, and they're willing to talk to the community. So I know there's a lot of people out there, and I believe there's a lot of misinformation out there to some extent. And, you know, people who talk about, you know, they don't know me. They don't know the officers here. So take a few minutes and come get to know them. Right. See what they're about, and talk to each other about what's going on. If we really want to make some change, then we need to discuss it together. And I think that would be a good first step as well. So.
But what about ride-alongs? Well, I know I can't wait to do my ride-along. I have not had that opportunity yet. But what about a residence or another group maybe doing a ride along with a police officer, and maybe a group or just residents sitting down talking to you or the police officers pertaining to the study that's here?
Yes, we can facilitate that. Like I said, a couple council members have done ride alongs. We can do that as well. That is not a problem at all. Many of our people who've gone through our Citizens Police Academy have done ride alongs, and other residents. You know, we will, there's certain calls we may not, you know, take everybody on, you know, some serious calls, but, you know, there's a lot of other things out there, you know, and just to talk to the officer and go on some of the other calls that we have to deal with. You know, over the years, we've taken on a lot of responsibility that we didn't used to have. You know, we now do all the animal control and things like that. So there's a lot of things that we do out there that I think people don't realize how much the police actually are doing. And I think this would be a good experience for them to do that. So yes, ride-alongs for residents and absolutely. You can contact my office and I'll be happy to set it up.
Well, I do, you know, with the death of George Floyd has, you know, pulled the rug off of a lot of things that's been happening in a lot of communities, a lot of cities. It's not only here in Cleveland Heights, it's all over the country. And I have to commend you on going out to look for this study without you being asked. So evidently something in your spirit either said something is going on or some changes need to be made. But I commend you on that, but I also commend the community and all the my colleagues for diving into this, because we want to make sure that our citizens are safe, number one, that everyone feel comfortable in their homes, number two, and make sure that we have an equal playing field where there's the racism is not there and the discrimination is not there.
Yeah.
So I'm going to, as we move forward, I'm going to reserve a lot of my questions until I can compile enough data to be able to give you some really good questions that I want to have answered.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Copps, for letting me.
Thank you. And I swore I'd keep this meeting to an hour, but I'm going to give Khalil an opportunity if he's got any comments or a question or two for the chief, and then we really are going to end in 5 minutes, the most.
Thank you, Chair. No, I won't even take that long. Craig, I wanted to say thank you for holding a fantastic meeting. I really appreciate this, and I really appreciate you taking the lead on this discussion.
Not getting it. Second.
And I'd also like to thank the chief, the captain, and the sergeant for being willing to have this conversation with us. You know, I know, and from what we've been told tonight, the implications of this data or the inferences that can be drawn from this data can lead us in one direction or another, but we're looking at data right now, and we're not on council, we're not making inferences, we're looking at data. And I wanted to make that clear, and I wanted to thank the three of you for being willing to be here with us with candor and openness, and also for taking the lead on this. So I appreciate that. Thank you, Craig. And with that, I guess that's it.
Melody, did you just join? Did you have any comments or?
Not joined earlier. Well, I do have some questions, but I'll save those for the next time, because I'm sure that what I hear everyone else saying is they're going to reserve their questions. So I know you're late. I appreciate that you've held this meeting, and I appreciate that this police chief has had the study done. And I'm going to take you up on that ride along, because we were going to have a ride along last year, and then COVID hit, and we didn't have our orientation. So I'll look forward to having that ride along and talking to some of your officers as well.
Okay, it's an eye opener. I first did ride alongs when I worked for the city of Cleveland in the 80s and the 90s, and it's an eye opener. Chief, thank you so much. I appreciate you working late again. Captain Young, thank you for also working late. And Sergeant Corrigan, I don't know if you were scheduled to work tonight, but if you missed dinner, thank you. And with that, I'm going to conclude the meeting. Goodbye, everyone. Thank you for participating.